आईओटी हैकिंग। आईओटी मींस इंटरनेट ऑफ थिंग्स। सो फर्स्ट व्हाट इज आईओटी? सो आईओटी फुल ऑफ आईओटी इज एक्चुअली इंटरनेट ऑफ थिंग्स एंड दैट इज कॉल्ड आईओटी। इट इज ऑल्सो नोन एज इंटरनेट ऑफ एवरीथिंग आईओई एंड इट रेफर्स टू द नेटवर्क ऑफ डिवाइसेज विद एन आईपी एड्रेस दैट हैव द कैपेबिलिटी ऑफ सेंसिंग कलेक्टिंग एंड सेंडिंग डेटा यूजिंग एम्बेडेड सेंसर्स कम्युनिकेशन हार्डवेयर एंड प्रोसेसर्स। इन आईओटी अ थिंग इज रेफर्ड टू एज अ डिवाइस एज द डिवाइस दैट इज इम्प्लीमेंटेड ऑन अ नेचुरल और मैन मेड और मशीन मेड ऑब्जेक्ट्स एंड हैविंग द फंक्शनैलिटी ऑफ कम्युनिकेटिंग ओवर द नेटवर्क। सो सिंपल दिस आईओटी मीन्स द इंटरनेट ऑफ थिंग्स थिंग्स दैट द डिवाइस नॉर्मली एंड दे यूज द इंटरनेट दे यूज द नेटवर्क टू कम्युनिकेट ऑल्सो एंड शेयर द डेटा। For example, these devices in industrial devices like tools, manufacturing, transporting tools, devices like these transporting cars, vehicles and all that. Then for the healthcare devices, we have health checkup devices, drugs. In the wearable devices, we have smart watches, smart wearables, televisions. Then for the home devices, we have the monitoring CCTVs, thermosensors. Energy sensors, the light bulbs, smart lights, now we are having those. So those can communicate, those can use the network to communicate. To do what? To send using sensing and collecting and sending the data by using the embedded sensors and communication hardwares. Now because it is on internet, it is on network, so it can be accessed through anywhere. So these IoT devices, just like the sound vibrations, pressures, temperature or humidity monitors, send the data to the IoT gateways. And from that IoT gateways, anyone can get the data from the internet. Now it will store into the data storage in cloud servers and then user can access the data from remote control using the mobile app. And whatever the connection sending the command, you can send the command through the internet to these devices also through the same IoT gateway. Like we are accessing a CCTV camera from the large distance, from like we set the CCTV camera in our home and we can check it from the other country, other region, anywhere else in the country also. Now the IoT architecture. So what is the architecture of IoT? So we can check the, we can see that as a layer wise. So first the application layer. This application layer delivery of various application to different user in IoT. So in the users, they can access the IoT devices through the application layer. Then we have the middleware layer. This is the device management and information management tool. Then in the internet layer, it is a connection between endpoints. So in the internet layer, it is the connection. Job of the connection, then access gateway layer, that is the protocol translation and messaging. Then edge technology layer, that is the sensor devices, machines, intelligent edge nodes on of all types. So this is the physical devices which is used to connect through the gateway layer and it uses the network layer to share the information through the network or internet. The middleware is the company or is the owner of those devices. So they do have their own database or cloud infrastructure to store the information and provide that information to the application. And the application, through the application, users can access the data. Just like this, we can see here. These are the end devices, then the protocol layer, this is the gateway layer, internet layer, and then this is the middleware layer where the data storage and cloud servers are there. And this is the application layer, which is the user access the devices through the application. Now, IoT application areas and devices. So what are the areas we have and what devices used in those areas? For example, in services sector, in the services sector like buildings, so under the building, the application groups, you have commercial or industrial also. locations like offices, education, rental, hospitality, healthcare, airport, stadiums, and normal industrials like process, clean room, campus. Now the devices used here is like HVAC, transport, fire and safety, lightning, security access, etc. So these are the devices which senses the network, like fire and safety devices which senses the fire and smoke, and then it can detect and then it can alarm and fire and start the fire safety devices. Lightings are there. Security accesses are there, where the doors are fixed with the security devices. If you have a card, then you can enter it. In the energy sector, we have these supply demand alternative oil gas infrastructure, oil and gas things, all oil and gas groups, application groups, where we have these power generation, trans and distribution, low voltage, power quality, energy management locations, solar, wind, cogeneration, electrochemical rigs, heads, pumps, pipelines there for gas and oil. And these are the devices which uses their turbine, windmills, UPS, batteries, generators, meters, drills, fuel cells, etc. Then for the consumer and home, we use the for the infrastructure, we use the wiring, network access, energy management. For awareness and safety, we use the security alerts and fire safety. For the elderly and children's monitoring, power protections, convenience and entertainment, we have HVAC, climate, lightning, lightings, appliances, entertainment devices, like for example digital cameras, power systems, mid e-readers, dishwashers, desktop computers, washers, dryers, meters, lights, TVs, MP3, games, consoles, alarm, etc. Then in the healthcare and life science, we have the care. In the care, we have hospitals, ER, mobile, POC, clinic, labs, doctor offices. In a Vivo home, like implants, home monitoring system. Under the research section, you can have the drug discovery, diagnostic labs, MRI, and the devices uses here, MRI, PDS, implement surgical equipment, pumps, monitors, telemedicines, etc. Then for the transportations, non-vehicles or non-vehicular or vehicular, non-vehicular like air, rail, marine, and vehicular like consumer, commercials, construction, off highway, trans systems like trolls, traffic management, navigations. Here the devices uses under the vehicles, lights, ships, planes, signals, tolls, etc. These are the devices which we use. These comes under the IoT, because they are intelligent devices, they use the networks, and they comes under the Internet of Things. Then also we have the industrial area, retail area, security, public safety, and IT networks. On these, we have these different applications, like for industrial resources automations, using for the mining, irrigation, agriculture, woodland, fluid process like petroleum, hydrocarbon, food, beverages, conversions, discreted like materials, papers, rubber, plastics, metal walking, electronics, assembly test, and these distributions like pipelines and canyons. And for these devices are like pumps, valves, vats, conveyor, fabrication, assembly, packaging, vessels and tanks. In for the retail area, specialty, hospitality, stores. For the specialty, fuel station, gaming, bowling, cinemas, discos, special events, hotel infrastructure, bar and coffee clubs for the hospitality. Then for the stores, supermarket, shopping centers, single sites, distribution centers. The devices used here as like POC, POS, terminals, tags, cashes, registers, vending machines, signs, etc. Then for the security and public security also, we have surveillance for the security equipment, tracking, public infrastructure, emergency services. For surveillance, we can use radar, satellite, invoid, military security, unmanned and fixed, and then equipments like weapons, vehicles, ships, aircrafts, and gear for tracking human, animal, postal, food, and healthcare baggages. And for public infrastructure, water treatment, building, environment, equipped, and personal police, fire, regulatories. for emergency services like ambulance, police, fire, homeland securities. The devices used here like tanks, fighter jets, battlefields, jeeps, cars, ambulance, homeland security environments, monitors. Then for IT and network, for public and enterprise, for public services, e-commerce, data centers, mobile carriers, ISPs, and for enterprise, IT data centers, offices, and privacy nets. And the devices we here use the servers, storage, PCs, routers, switches, PBX, and all that devices. Now, in IT technology and protocols, we have these different things like short range wireless communications. In this, we have Bluetooth low energy, which is Bluetooth low energy. We have light fidelity, that is Li-Fi. We have light fidelity, which is actually called Li-Fi. Then we have near field communication, that is NFC. We have QR code and barcode, radio frequency identifications, RFIDs, threads, Wi-Fi, Wi-Fi direct, Z-Wave, Zigbee. Then for medium range wireless communication, we use the HA Low, LTE Advanced. Then for the long range wireless communication, we use a low power wide area networking, that is LPWAN, low range WAN or Sigvox and NEUL, very small aperture terminal VSAT, and also cellular. Then for wired communication, we use Ethernet, multimedia, cover coax alliances, MOCA, and then power line communication, PLC. For IoT operating systems, we use these operating systems. These are the operating system for the IoT. So these are the technology and protocols we use, and this is the operating system for the IoT, like Rite OS, ARM and Embed OS, then RealSense OS X, Nucleus RTOS, then Brillo, Contiki, Zyber. We have Ubuntu Core, Integrity RTOS. We have Apache Minuet. So these are the IoT operating system which used into those IoT devices. Now this is the IoT communication model. First, device to device model. In this, suppose we have a light bulb from the manufacturer. We have a light bulb from the manufacturer A, and then we have the light switch from manufacturer B. So how they do the communication through the wireless network? This is what the device to device model, where the light bulb is communicating directly to the other light sensor, so that it can detect the sense the light, when to enable the light, disable the light, and whatever. In wireless network, it can use the Bluetooth, Z-Wave, or Zigbee. So this kind of network it can use. Now the other option is that device to cloud model. Now in this device to cloud model, device with the temperature sensor, for example, there is a device which can sensor the temperature. So what it do, it will send the information to the application service provider through the HTTP, TLS, TCP protocol, and then from there the device with the carbon monoxide sensor, it will get the information from the application service provider, that is stored into the cloud. So here it will detect the temperature, and the information will go to the cloud and store, and then from that cloud the information will go to the carbon monoxide sensor devices. Then we have the other model, which is device to gateway model. Now device to gateway model, where suppose we have a device with the temperature sensor. Now first it will do what? It will upload the device information to the application provider, like a service provider, and then it can also send the locally, it will send it to the gateway. So if the device with the carbon monoxide sensor, if it wants to get the information, so it can get it from two way. Either it can get it from the application service provider from the cloud, or it can directly get the information from the device through the gateway. Through the gateway, it will get like from the Bluetooth network, or through the wireless, or the other LRWPN. So it will connect it to these network through these gateway. So the device sends the information through the gateway to the device, other device, otherwise it can go through the cloud service provider. So it can use both device to gateway model, it can also use the device to cloud model. Then back end data sharing model. In this, suppose we have the light sensor here. Now protocols take like COAP or HTTP, it will send the information to the cloud service provider, application service provider. Now it will go, this is the first service provider. Now through this it will go to the application service provider number 2, and also it will go to the application service provider number 3. It is like the back end data sharing model, where they are sharing the data with the other service providers. So this is the communication model we have. Then challenges of IoT. What are the challenges we have with the IoT devices? First, lack of security and privacy. In these IoT devices, we don't have the much security features, and also the privacy also, that because it can be connected to any. Then vulnerable web interfaces. It is web interfaces are vulnerable. It can have a vulnerability of all the web services. Then large legal regulatory and right issues. There are very less legal regulatories are available right now, because this thing is just introduced, so this is a new thing. So right now, till now, or right now we can say that there is not much legal regulatories and right issues are there. So it is not fixed till now, that it has not introduced more legal or things, legal consequences or legal, we can say, laws for this. Then number 4, that is default weak and hard coded credentials are there. Now hard coded, that means it is already fixed with the hardware, so you can sometime you are not able to change it. Also sometime it uses the default, which is very weak, and also sometime it is the hard coded credentials, so it is known by the attackers like this is the default, so it can use it. Then clear text protocols and unnecessary open ports are also there. Coding errors are there, which can lead to the buffer overflow. Then storage issues are there. Then difficult to update firmware and OS. Interoperability standard issues are also there, like one company's devices are not able to work with the other company's devices. Then physical theft and tampering can be possible. Physically can someone thief your devices. Then lack of vendor support for fixing the vulnerabilities. There is no patches released for these kind of things. Emergency economy and development issues are also there. Now the threats and threats versus the opportunity. Now threat means what? If misconfigured and misapprehended, IoT poses an unprecedented risk to personal data, privacy and safety. And if apprehended and protected, IoT will boost transmission, communication, delivery of service and standard of living. So it can be very useful if we have properly configured and protected. So it can boost the transmission and communication and also delivery of service. Now if it is properly not configured, misconfigured, then it can lead to possess unprecedented risk, and we can lose the personal data and privacy and safety also. Now the IoT security problems we have. So first, if you see the IoT, that is the application network plus the mobile plus cloud is equal to what? IoT. That means the cloud, where the devices are stored the information, the mobiles, that is the devices which we can access the IoT devices, and network, through the network we can access, and the application which used to access the devices. So combination of these all, we call it IoT. Now cloud means what? The improper authentication can be there, no encryption for storage and communication, insecure web interfaces. Now these cloud storages are provided by the vendor, like who providing the hardware. So those vendors basically are the hardware vendors, they don't work on the software part. So improper authentication, sometimes they don't work on the software part, so they misconfigure, they don't care concentrate on these things. So it can lead to the improper authentication, no encryption for storage and communication, insecure web interfaces can be there. Then mobile means insecure API, lack of communication channels, encryption, authentication, lack of storage security. And these mobile APIs, these are also used to connect the cloud. So if the cloud is applications are not properly configured, so mobile is also not configured. On the network, firewall, improper communication, encryption, service lack of automatic updates also there. Then for the application, validation of the inputted string, auth end, auth z, no automatic security updates, default passwords may be available or may be configured there. There are the security problems there. So these are the security problems like validation, input string are where problem, auth network, auth z, no automatic security updates will be there and can be a default password. Now, open web application security policy or this program, it says that there are some top IoT vulnerabilities and obstacles we have. So it is defined by this OWASP. This is the project of open web web application security project. So they have defined, they have identified these top 10 vulnerabilities and obstacles for these IoT devices. And these are first, insecure web interface. Now in web interface, default credentials can be used, absence of the account lockout mechanism are there. And in the web interface, we can have the cross-site request forgery attack, SQL injection attack, cross-site scripting vulnerabilities can be there. Then number two is insufficient authentication or authorization. In this, insecure password recovery mechanism can be there, weak passwords are the obstacles. Then absence of the two-factor authentication, like after giving the password and login credentials, you have to get some other factor also, like the finger sensor, eye sensor, or maybe we can say the authentication code sent to the mobile. So it should be two-way factor. If it is absence, then can be a problem. Insecure network services, like vulnerable to denial of service attack, exposed port via PNP, plug and play, then unwanted port are open, lack of transport encryption integrity verification, that may be sensitive and confidential information is sent unencrypted, absence of SSL, TLS or not properly configured, use of proprietary encryption protocols, privacy concerns are there, a lot of personal information is collected, and collected information is not properly managed and protected, and user is not given a choice to allow collection of certain types of data. Then insecure cloud interface, no review of interfaces for security vulnerabilities, presence of weak passwords, absence of two-factor authentications, insecure mobile interface, presence of the weak password, absence of the account lockout mechanism, absence of two-factor authentication, then insufficient security configurability, like absence of password security options, absence of encryption option, no option for enabling security logging, then insecure software or firmware, that means insecure update servers, transmission of unencrypted devices updates, unsigned device updates are also a problem, poor physical security. In this, unwanted external ports like our USB ports are there, access to operating system via remote media is there, not able to limit the administrative capabilities. These are the 10 vulnerabilities and obstacles released by these open web application security project. Then for the IoT attack surface, we have these different kind of attack for the IoT devices. First, device memory can be attacked by using the clear text credential, because it is using the clear text credential, third party credential or encryption keys, and it can be attack on the ecosystem access control, that means implicit trust between components, enrollment security, decommission system, lost access procedure can be do. Then device physical interface, on devices physical interface, firmware extraction, user CLI and admin CLI, privilege escalation, reset to secure state, removal of storage media, then the device web interface, on device web interface, the attack can be SQL injection attack, cross-site scripting attack, cross-site request forgery attack, username encryption, weak password, account lockout, and known default credential attack can be there. And on the device firmware, the hard-coded credentials are there. It can be a problem. Sensitive information disclosure, sensitive URL disclosure, encryption keys are not there. Firmware version display and or last update date also. On device network services, information disclosure can be possible. User and admin CLI can be possible to see. Injection and denial of services. Encrypted services, properly poorly implemented encryption, UB user plug and play, vulnerable UDP services are used. For administrative interface, SQL injection can be done, cross-site scripting, security, encryption option, logging option, two-factor authentication, inability to wipe the device. For the local storage, unencrypted data, data encrypted with discovered keys, lack of data integrity checks are there. So these are the attack surfaces, and on those surfaces this kind of attack can be done and these kind of problems are there. Then also other surfaces are cloud web interface. Here also it is a cloud web server, so we can also have a SQL injection, cross-site scripting, transport encryption, insecure password recovery mechanism, two-factor authentication is not there. So this kind of attack can be there on this surface. Update mechanism surface, we can use the attacker can update sent without encryption the problem, update not signed, update location writable, update verification not there, malicious update can accept it, missing update mechanism, no manual update mechanisms are there. Now third party backend APIs, unencrypted PLL sent, encrypted PLL sent, or device information leaked, location leaked. Then on mobile application, implicitly trusted by device cloud, then username enumeration, account lockout, known default credential, weak password, insecure data storage, transport encryption, insecure password recovery mechanism. Then on vendor backend APIs, it can have a inherent trusted of cloud or mobile application, weak authentication, weak access controls, injection attacks can also be there. Then ecosystem communication, here we can have health checks, heartbeats, ecosystem commands, deprovisionings, pushing updates. Then on network traffic, LAN on internet, short range or non-standard. So these are the attack surfaces we have, and these kind of different problems in attack we can have on these attack surfaces. Now for IoT, what are the threats we have? In IoT, devices on the internet have a very few security protection mechanism against various emergency threats. Attacker often exploit these poorly protected devices on the internet to cause physical damage to the network, to wiretap the communication, and also to launch disruptive attacks such as distributed denial of service. So these are the threats of these IoT devices. If they compromise, so they can cause the denial, distributed denial of service attack. That means attacker can use those IoT devices to do the attack on some other services because they are connected to network and internet. Then attack on the HVAC system, that is HVAC systems. Then rolling code attack can also be there. Bluebone attack, jamming attack, remote access using backdoor, remote access using telnet, then Sybil attack, exploit attack, man in the middle attack, replay attack, forge malicious device, side channel attack, and ransomware attack. These are the different attacks we have on this IoT devices, and these are the threats we have. Now first, that hacking IoT devices. Now the general scenario for hacking the IoT devices, this is a general scenario. Now where we have this network, this is the devices we have, IoT devices, for example smartphone, mobile devices, or even a CCTV camera. Now they connect to the cloud or gateway or internet. Through that they are connected to the server. Now the attacker can do what? It can use the fake server to store the data of these genuine devices, or it can use the fake devices to store the data into the genuine server. And it can do what? It can actually do the eavesdropping. This also lead to the denial of service attack. It can do the denial of service attack. Attacker can do what? It can initiate the attack by first exploiting the vulnerability in the devices and then installing a malicious software in their operating system. Then multiple infected IoT devices are referred to as an army of botnets. The target is attacked with a large volume of requests from multiple IoT devices present in different locations. So attacker can do what? It can first infect the IoT devices with the malicious software or Trojan or botnet, and then using those devices, because they are connected to internet, it can do what? It can send an attack on a particular target. So first, what attacker will do? Attacker gains the remote access to the vulnerable devices through the Trojan, and when they connect, when they are infected, the attacker injects the malicious malware into IoT devices to turn them into botnet. And when they turn into botnet, they will connect to the command and control center of these botnets, and it is on the attacker system. And then from that attacker system, in the command and control, it will give the command to attack on some target, and then server goes offline and the unable to process any further request, and it becomes the distributed denial of service attack. Then attacker can use and exploit the havoc like HVAC. Now many organizations use the internet connected heating, ventilation and air conditioner. This is the meaning of HVAC, that means heating, ventilation and air conditioning. So it uses the devices to heat the room or heat the environment. Ventilations are there to clean the environment, clean the office, air pollutions and air environment, and also for air conditioning to cool the environment. So these systems, without implementing the security mechanism, giving attackers a gateway to hack operating system cooperation systems. This havoc systems have many security vulnerabilities that are exploited by attackers to steal the login credentials, gain access to havoc system and perform further attack on the organization's network. So attacker can do what? Attacker using the Sudan search for vulnerable IC system. Now the Sudan browser, Sudan searches, it is a search engine, and it can search for the different IoT devices in the different places, in the different locations. So through this, it can check the vulnerable devices, and through those vulnerable devices, attacker tries to default user credentials to access these IoT devices and IoT systems. So it will try to access the system, and once it is get into the system, attacker gets an access to the havoc system through the ICS, internet connection system, and then through the this havoc system, attacker controls the temperature from the havoc or carry out further attack on local network also. Now rolling code attack. Now in this rolling code attack, that means what? The most of the smart vehicles as a smart locking system that includes radio frequency signals transmitted in the form of the code from the modern key fob that locks or unlock the vehicle. So you may have seen that when you the modern cars or modern vehicles do use these locking devices, like they have a key, and in that key they have the locking option. When you press that key, so it sends the signal through the radio frequency to the car, and in the car they have a sensor, so they sense the signal and they do what? They lock and unlock. So this code which locks or unlock a car or a garage is called as a rolling code or hopping code. So attacker uses a jammer to thwart the transmission of the code from the key fob to the receiver in the vehicle, and after obtaining the code, an attacker can use it to unlock and steal the vehicle. So what they can do, first attacker do the jamming, it will jam the signal, and they user, if the victim is trying to open the car or unlock the car, it will not able to do that. It will jam the signal. So first, suppose the victim presses the car remote button to unlock the car. Now the attacker will do what? Attacker uses the jammer to jam the car's receptions of rolling code sent and simultaneously sniff the first code. So it jams the signal and also sniff the code. Then what? The car does not unlock, so victim tries again by sending the second code. Now the attacker sniff the second code also. Now attacker will do what? It will run the second code on the second attempt by the victim, and attacker forward the first code that unlocks the car. Now when the first code was jammed, it was available on the attacker, so it sends the first code to the vehicle. And then what? The recorded second code is used later by an attacker to unlock and steal the vehicle. So first code, it will sniff and keep it into itself, and second code it will send to the first code it will send to the car, and the car will be unlocked when the second code second time pressed by the victim. So victim feels that there is no problem, the car is open because I have pressed the open key. But the first request code is sent to the car, and the second time when that victim presses the key, it is stored by the attacker. And next time it will use that code to unlock the car and can steal the car. Then bluebone attack. In bluebone attack, this bluebone attack is performed on Bluetooth connection to gain access and take full control of the target devices. And it is a collection of various techniques based on the known vulnerabilities of Bluetooth protocol. And Bluebone is compatible with all software versions and does not require any user interaction or precondition or configuration, except that the Bluetooth device active, Bluetooth being active. So normally we don't have to do any configuration, only the Bluetooth is active and we just have to pair the device. So it will do connect. Now after gaining access to one device, an attacker can penetrate into any corporate network using that device to steal critical information about the organization and spread malware to the nearby devices. So for example, attacker do what? First, attacker discover the Bluetooth devices, then second receives the MAC address of that device, then what? Send the probe, and receiving the OS information, try to send the probe to get the information about the OS. And then what? It will try to gain the access and control printer to access the corporate network. For example, there is a Bluetooth printer there. So if the attacker is able to get the access of that printer, so it can see that whatever the corporate network or the organization is printing on that printer, so it can see all those documents. It can be a sensitive document, so it can have all those documents which is printed by that printer. Then jamming attack. In the jamming attack, that jamming attack is a type of attack in which the communication between wireless IoT devices are jammed in order to compromise it, just like we have seen for the car. So attacker transmit radio signal randomly with the frequency as the sensor node are sending signals for communication. So as a result, the network gets jammed, making endpoint unable to send or receive any messages. So what the attacker do? It will transmit the radio signal randomly with the frequency as the sensor node are sending the signal. So the sensor is sending the signal through that frequency, and attacker will also send the signal on the frequency, but it will send the random signals. So the signals will be, the devices will be desynchronized, and they do what? They are jammed. Now it will do the jam for the devices to do the other sniffing or other attack. So doing the jamming is for the other type of attack. Now hacking is smart grid industrial devices like remote access using backdoor. So attacker gather basic information about the target organization using a various social engineering technique first. Then attacker send the phishing email to the employees with the malicious attachment. Now when any employee opens the email and clicks on the attachment, a backdoor is automatically installed in the target system. Now, using the backdoor, the attacker gain access to the private network of the organization. So very simple, it can get the access through the malware and Trojan also. It send it to the attacker, it send it to the user or victim through the email. And once they have installed it, they will be infected and they can open the backdoor. The other IoT attacks are like cyber attack. This is where attacker uses multiple forged identities to create a strong illusion of traffic congestion, affecting communication between neighboring nodes and network. It is again trying to denial of service or jamming the attack. Exploit kits. Attacker uses malicious script to exploit poorly patched vulnerabilities in an IoT devices, and it try to use those exploit to get the access. Man in the middle attack. Man in the middle attack, an attacker pretend to be the legitimate sender who intercepts all the communication between the sender and receiver and hijack the communication. Replay attack is used where attacker intercept the legitimate messages from a valid communication and continuously send the intercepted messages to the target device to perform a denial of service attack or crash the target device. Forge malicious device. Here attacker replaces the authentic IoT device with the malicious device if they have physical access to the network. So it can do what? It can change the physical original device and put it the malicious device which has the malicious code. Side channel attack. In this, attacker extract the information about the encryption keys by observing the emission of signals, that is side channel, from IoT device. So it is just observe the signals, and in that signals it will try to extract the encryption mechanism or try to extract the key. Ransomware attack, where ransomware is a type of malware that uses encryption to block user access to his or her devices, either by locking the screen or by locking a user's files, and then it will ask for the ransom, that if you want to unlock, if you want to get the key, then you have to pay this amount of money as a Bitcoin. Mostly it is as a Bitcoin. Then IoT attacks in different sectors. So these are the different sectors we have, like building sectors, energy and industrial sector, consumer and homes, life science sectors. So in these different sectors, different kind of attacks the attacker can do. Like in building sectors, it can do the access control attack, where it can get the access to the devices. Man in the middle attack, it can do to listen the communication. Denial of service attack, it do to flood the data stream with the communication to deplate the system requires. It can do the eavesdropping also to collecting the exchange messages also. Possible consequences, simple, it will lead to the loss of confidentiality, availability, privacy and all this. Then energy and industrial area, again for the access control, it can get the physical access of the remote devices. Then reconnaissance, it can engage with the target system in order to obtain the information. It can do the denial of service attack again to make the service unavailable for the legitimate user by flooding the system service communications. Then it will do eavesdropping again to collect the transmission information. And again, what is the possible consequences? Same, loss possibility, loss of data availability, confidentiality. Then consumer and home. In this denial of service attack, it can make the service unavailable for the system users, for the authenticated user, legitimate user, by flooding the communication channel, by forged request. Then it can do the access control, try to get the physical access devices. It can do the man in the middle attack to listen the communication between two endpoint. Again, it is loose. It is possibly consequences are like loss of data availability, confidentiality, availability. Then for the healthcare and life science, it can do the signal jamming attack. Signal jamming attack, that means electromagnetic interference or inter-detection using the same frequency band wireless system. Then it can getting the physical access control of the remote devices, then or the remote devices access remotely also, denial of service attack to make these services unavailable. It can do the eavesdropping to collect information, messages, exchange messages. Sinkhole attack to compromise a node, try to attract the traffic by advertising a fake route. Then SQL attack can also be done on this reputation system in subvert by forging multiple identities. Again, it is lead to the same thing, like possible consequences are like loss of availability, confidentiality, availability. Then for the transportation, automobile security and public safety, here also type of attacks are like impersonation attack, that attacker successfully assumes the identity of the other legitimate user. It can do the SQL attack, reputation of system, subvert by the forging multiple identities. It can do the GPS spoofing, devices are GPS, decipher the GPS receiver by broadcasting the incorrect GPS signals. It can do the denial of service attack to make the service unavailable. It can do the eavesdropping to collect the exchange messages, access control to gain the access physical devices. It can do the wormhole attack, where it captures the packet from one location and send to another network. Then black hole attack, where router, instead of relaying packet, it will start discarding them. And same consequences are like loss of data, confidentiality, availability, and loss of data. And for the IT and networks, we can have a brute force attack, where it is trying to generate a large number of guessing in order to find the correct credential to gain access to the system. Denial of service attack to make the service unavailable and try to get the access control, try to get the access of the physical devices. And all is these possible consequences are like loss of data, availability, confidentiality, and loss of data. This is one of the case study of Dyn attack. Now here what happened, Maria is a piece of malware. It is called Maria. It is a piece of malware that deliberately finds Internet of Things devices to infect. So it is on Internet, it is roaming around on Internet, and it do what? It deliberately try to find the IoT specific devices. Once infected, so Maria adds the infected IoT to a botnet. It makes this IoT devices as a botnet. Then Maria was built for two main purposes: find and infect other IoT devices to further grow the botnets, then participate in DDD distributed denial of service attack based upon commands received from the remote CA command and control infrastructure. So stage one, it infect the devices. So first, continuously scan for IoT devices that are accessible over the internet. Then it primarily scan for port 22 for SSH, 23, 5747, etc., and that are open and can easily be configured to scan for others. Then once connected to an IoT, it attempt to log in using list of username and password combinations included in the malware to gain access and infect the device. Then infected device then scan other networks looking for more IoT devices and launches distributed denial of service attack. Now it try to use the list of username and password to gain the access, and it is having the fixed username and password into the file. So it uses those username and password to try to gain the access. Then under the step 2, it will protect itself first. So kills other process running on the IoT device such as SSH, Telnet, SCDP to prevent the owner from gaining remote access to the IoT device while infected. So it will disable these services so that the owner of the IoT is not able to connect the IoT device through SSH, through Telnet, or even from the HTTP. Then rebooting the IoT device can remove the malware, but it can quickly become infected again. Now we can remove malware by just rebooting it, but very soon it will get infected again. Why? Because the other devices near this IoT device is also infected. So the other devices will quickly infect this device again. Now in the third stage, what it do, it launch the attack. Here this Miria infected IoT devices launch different types of attacks as part of the malware. When attacking using HTTP GET fluids, MiriaBot uses a list of default user agents. So default user agents like the Mozilla Firefox or Chrome or some other browser user agent. So using those user agent, it do what? It try to flood the HTTP GET request on a target system. Now, what is the IoT hacking methodology? So what is the IoT device hacking? First, the objective of the IoT device hacking is to compromise the smart devices like CCTV cameras, automobiles, printers, door locks, washing machines, in order to gain unauthorized access to network resources and IoT devices. So how a hacker can profit from this IoT when successfully compromised? This is important. So first, what is the benefit? First, it can create a botnet of the compromised IoT device to launch further distributed denial of service attack. Then it can sell the compromised data in a black market also. Like it can create lots of botnets and then it can sell those botnets in a black market. Then carry out any number of malicious activities on compromised IoT devices. Then install the ransomware to block access to an IoT device and ask for ransom. So it can install the malware or on the device, and when the user, the owner of the device, try to access the device, it will say that if you want to get the access, you have to pay the ransom. Then compromise the IoT device could be used to steal the identity of the victim and carry out the credit card related frauds. So some of the devices can have information about the owner also. Like we are using the smart mobiles. In the smart mobile, we create profiles, we use these different options to store the information. If it is compromised, then it can lead to the identity. The attacker can steal the identity. Compromised CCTV cameras could be used to snoop on families. And if the CCTV cameras are compromised, so it can use that to snoop on families also. So these are the benefits of compromising the IoT devices. Now, what is the methodology we have? So methodology is, first, it will start from the beginning, like it will start from gathering the information. So first step is to gather the information about the IoT device. So that the information such as the IP addresses, protocol used, open ports, device type, geolocation of the device, manufacturing number and manufacturing company of a device. Then the second step is to scan for the vulnerability. Now vulnerability scanning helps the attacker to identify the IoT device with a weak configuration, such as hidden exploit, firmware bugs, weak settings and password, poorly encrypted communication, etc. Then after getting the vulnerabilities, it can launch the attacks. So the vulnerabilities found or exploit further to launch various attacks, such as distributed denial of service attack, rolling code attacks, jamming signals, Sybil attack, man in the middle attack, data and identity theft attack. Now once the attack is successful, that means the attacker gained the access. So gain access, that means the based of the vulnerabilities in IoT, the attacker may turn the device into a backdoor to gain the access to an organization network without infecting any end system that is protected by the IPS, IDS, firewalls, antiviruses, and etc. Then what? After gaining the access, the attacker want to maintain the access, so it remains undetected by clearing the logs, updates the firmware, and uses malicious programs such as backdoors, trojans, etc. to maintain the access. So this is the methodology we have. Now first, to gather the information, we can use the different tools like Sudan. This Sudan is a online site where you can get the different information about all the internet connected devices, such as a router, traffic lights, CCTVs, cameras, servers, smartphone devices. Attacker can make use of this tool to gather information such as IP address, host name, ISP, devices information, location, and the banner of the target IoT devices. So attacker can gather information on the target device using the filters also. It can use the filters such as it can use the webcam XP. It wants to see the webcams, and it can also use a filter of country. Like we want to see only webcams of USA, or it can use a filter for the city. Like it can use, it want to see only the country, city of the Seattle. Then also it can use the location, latitude and longitude. So it can use the geotag also. So we can go to this Sudan and we can use this to find. For example, now this is the search engine. For example, I want to see webcam XP. I will search this for webcams. Now it is showing me webcams from the different locations. It is showing the IP address. It is showing these locations, what it is using here, SSL certificate or these and that. And some of that we can see the location. Some of that is not that secure. So we can actually see. And also it is showing some of them is honeypot. It is from Switzerland, Belgium, Belgium. Switzerland, Belgium, Switzerland, Romania. And if it is possible, then we can get the access of that. If I try to open the URL. So you can see the IP address and it can open the access also. It is not opening here. I will try this one. It is also not opening. Now remember, I am not using any filters here. It is not targeted here. It is just anything. I am just using it to get anything. And you know what? These are also, it is showing that these are honeypots. So these are honeypots. So when I try to open it, it is not opening. Now if I want to go next, then it says what? Please create the Sudan account and log in into access more result. Or if I try to use the filters, so again it will tell me to create the account. So if I try to use the filters, again it will say me, it will tell me to create the account. So first you have to create the account, you have to log in with this, and then you can use this. So you can create the account or you can log in with your Google account, Twitter account or live account. So you can log in with this and then you can use it freely and you can go and search on. Like for example, let's log in with Google account I have. Now I think I can go next now and I can see more results. I can see now more results here. And if I select this, we have top organizations in this site, we have a top product of this site, we can see the country on this site. Let's say I want to check the United States. So now I am using the filter here, country is equal to country is United States. So I am using the filter. Now here I can see some of that. Some of that it is showing some this webcam. It is not secure, it is not protected. Even we can see the camera, what is it showing here. Okay, we can see this also. Now where is it from? It is from the United States, Cape Coral. This is the IP address. And this is the request we are getting. We can see what is it showing here. We can go there. We can move the camera. Okay, it is some kind of beach there. So somebody is there also. So this is how this Sudan search engine can give you the information. We have not done it targeted search, but we can do the targeted search also. Then information gathering, we can use this multi-ping tool also. Attacker can use this multi-ping to find an IP address of any IoT device in the targeted network. After obtaining the IP addresses of an IoT device, the attacker can perform the further scanning to identify the vulnerability present in the device. So instead of performing the scanning to identify the IP address of any IoT device, first you should open the multi-ping, then click on the file, add the address range, a specific range you want to have to scan, and then set the router gateway IP address, initial the address to add the drop field, number of addresses you want to scan, and then run the scan. So it will scan each and every IP addresses and try to show you that which IP addresses are actually having the IoT device. Then also we can use the nmap. We can scan the vulnerabilities using the nmap. Attacker can use the vulnerability scanning tool such as nmap to identify all the IoT devices connected to the network along with their open ports and services. So we can use the nmap, and with that we can use these options to scan the network for the TCP services, for the UDP, and to identify the IPv6 capability also in the device. Then we can use, attacker can use the RIoT vulnerability scanner. This Retina IoT vulnerability scanner identifies the at-risk IoT devices such as IP cameras, DVRs, printers, routers, etc. So these tools gives an attacker view of all the IoT devices and their associated vulnerabilities. So these are scanners, and this can scan the vulnerabilities all the connected devices, identify the vulnerable IoT devices, check for the default or hard-coded password, perform external scans of up to 256 IP addresses, generates reports of IoT vulnerabilities and their remediations also. Then we can use the phone 6 also. This is a sniffing, so we can use this to sniff the network. So attacker use this tool like a phone 6 to sniff the traffic of the IoT devices, and phone 6 uses sniffers to capture the 6 LOPN traffic and renders the network state in a graphical user interface. It shows as a graphical interface. It captures all the RPL related information and identifies abnormal behavior. It combines multiple sniffers and captures live packets from deployed network in a non-intrusive manner. Now once you get the information, vulnerability information, then we can attack by using these different tech tools. Like we can do the rolling attack, rolling code attack using the RF crack tool. This RF crack tool attacker use to obtain the rolling code sent by the victim to unlock the vehicle, and later use the same code for stealing the vehicle. RF crack is used for testing RF communication between any physical device that communicates over sub gigahertz frequencies. Some of the commands used by an attacker to perform rolling code attacks are given below, like these. For replay attack, it will use this. It is a Python script to check, so it will give the I option to check it. Then with the rolling code, it will use RM and then code. For that, then access the RSI range. It can access the range also with this command, and for jamming, it can use the -J option to jam the signals. So first I will sniff the things, and then when it gets the information, then it will use these commands to do the adjustment of the range and also do the jamming. Then we can hacking using the Zigbee device, hacking the Zigbee device with 85 Zigbee framework. So this Zigbee devices are also there. Most of the IoT devices use Zigbee protocol for short range wireless communication. So attacker finds vulnerabilities in ZigBee based IoT and smart devices and exploit them using tools like this Etify ZigBee framework. This ZigBee protocol make use of 16 different channels for all communication. An attacker used this ZigBee stumbler from Etify ZigBee framework to identify the channel used by the target device. An attacker can perform replay attack by capturing any replay, replaying the same packet to observe the behavior of the device. Then, for Bluebone attack, we have HackRF1. So IoT devices include some sort of wireless communication using this RF or ZigBee or the LoRa. So attacker use the HackRF1 to perform attacks such as Bluebone or airborne attacks such as replay, fuzzing, jamming. So this HackRF1 is an advanced hardware and software defined radio with the range of 1 MHz to 6 GHz. Now it transmit and receive radio waves in full duplex mode, so it is easy for attackers to perform attacks using this device. So it will receive and send the data. It is a half duplex mode, so it is easy for attacker to perform attacks using this device. So it will not send its own information because it is half duplex. So it can sniff wide range of wireless protocol from GSM to Z-Wave, and it is a hardware device. Now gaining remote access using the telnet. Now most of the remote devices, these IoT devices, has a telnet, has their remote access protocol set to telnet. So attacker can perform the port scanning to learn about open port and services on the target in IoT device. Now many embedded system application in IoT devices, such as this industrial control system, routers, VoIP phones, televisions, these implement remote access capability using the telnet. So if an attacker identifies that the telnet port is open, he or she exploits this vulnerability to gain the remote access to the device. Attacker use tools such as Shodan and Synsys to gain remote access to the target device. Then for maintaining access, it uses the exploiting firmware. Now attacker exploit the firmware installed on the IoT device to maintain the access on the device. So after gaining the remote access, attacker explore the file system to access the firmware on the device, and then attacker uses the tools such as firmware mode kit to reconstruct the malicious firmware from the legitimate firmware. So the firmware is legitimate, it will reconstruct it with the malicious code. The firmware mode kit allows for the easy destruction and reconstruction of the firmware images for various embedded devices. Then other information gathering tools are like Synes. It is also allow the attacker to continuously monitor every reachable servers and devices on the internet. Then we have Thingful. This is a search engine for the internet of the Internet of Things to find and use open IoT data from around the world, just like the Shodan. Then we have a sniffing tools like Z-Wave sniffers. Z-Wave sniffer is used to sniff the traffic, perform real-time monitoring and capture packets from all Z-Wave networks. Then we have CloudShark, UEQ protocol analyzer, Periton protocol analyzer, Wireshark, TCP dump also can scan. Then for vulnerability scanning, we have the other tools like we have BStrom. BStrom is a smart fuzzer to find buffer overflow vulnerabilities by automating and documenting the process of delivering corrupted input and watching for an unexpected response from the application. Then we have Rapid7 Metasploit Pro also. We have IoT Sploit, we have IoT Seeker, Bitfender Open Scanner, IoT Inspector. Then we have IoT Hacking Tools. For hacking tools, we have Formalizer Enterprise. This enables devices, vendors and security professional to perform an automated security assessment on software that powers the IoT device firmware in order to identify configuration and application vulnerability. Then we have Chip Whisper, RFCAT, RollJam, KillerBee, GATech, IO, GT, GT Egglator. Now, how we can do the countermeasures? So how to defend against this IoT hacking? First, disable the guest and demo user accounts if enabled. So if any guest or demo accounts are there, first disable those things. Then then use the lockout feature to lock out accounts for excessive invalid login attempts. So if someone try to guess the password continuously or multiple attempts it must lock the account. Then implement the strong authentication mechanism, locate control system, network and devices behind firewall and isolate them from the business network. So if the devices, IoT devices are not under the firewall, then isolate them from the network, remove them from the business network. Then implement the IPS and IDS in the network for the IoT devices also. Then implement end-to-end encryption and use the public key infrastructure, PKI. Use the VPN architecture to secure the communication, remote communication. Deploy the security as a unified integrated system. Allow any trusted IP address to access device from the internet. That means allow only trusted IP addresses. Disable telnet. Disable UTNP port on routers. Prevent the devices against physical tampering. Patch vulnerabilities and update the device firmware regularly. Monitor traffic on port number 48101 as the infected device attempt to spread the malicious file using this port 48101. This is the known port, but we should have to monitor every port which is not used and it is still open. So we should disable those ports. Then guideline, the general guideline for IoT devices manufacturing companies when they are manufacturing the devices. So for this company manufacturing IoT devices should make sure that they implement the basic security measures like SSL TLS should be used for communication purpose. There should be a mutual check on SSL certificate and the certificate revocation list. Use of a strong password should be encouraged. The device update process should be simple and secure with a chain of trust. Then implementing account lockout mechanism after certain wrong login attempts to prevent brute force attack. Lock the device down whenever and wherever possible to prevent them from attacks. Periodically checking the device for unused tools and using whitelisting to allow only trusted tools or application to run. Use secure boot chain to verify all software that is executed on the device. So by using the secure boot chain, it will verify all the softwares which is there in the device and executing. So it will detect if any malware is there and it is running boot time. Now these are the Open Web Application Security Project top 10 vulnerability solutions. We have seen vulnerabilities. Now these are the solutions. For the insecure web interface, the solution is enabling the default credential to be checked. Change default should be changed. Enable the account lockout mechanism and conduct periodic assessment of web application. For insufficient authentication authorization, again implement the secure password recovery mechanism. Use a strong and complex password and also enable two-way factor authentication. For insecure network services, close open ports, open network port, disable UPnP, review network services for vulnerability itself. Then lack of transport layer security, encryption, integration, verification. So encrypt the communication between endpoints, maintain SSL and TLS implementation, and do not use proprietary encryption protocols. Privacy concerns, minimize the data collection by the IoT devices, anonymize the collected or data, provide end user the ability to decide what data they want to give or what they want to collect it. For insecure cloud interface, solution is to conduct the assessment of all the cloud interface, use a strong and complex password, enable two-way authentication factor. Then insecure mobile interface, again use a strong and complex password, enable account lockout mechanism and also two-factor authentication. For insufficient security configurability, for that enable the security login mechanism to log everything, allow the selection of encryption option and notify end user regarding security alerts. For insecure software or firmware, secure update servers and verify updates before installing and sign updates. Use always sign updates. poor physical security. For that, minimize the external ports such as USB ports. Then protect operating system, include ability to limit administrative capabilities. Then IoT framework security consideration. First on edge, communication encryption must be there in strong encryption, update components, no default password should be used. For gateway, multi-directional encrypted communication should be there, a strong authentication of all the components, automatic update must be there. For cloud platform, encrypted communication, secure web interface, authentication, encrypted storage, automatic update must be there. Mobiles, local storage security, encrypted communication channels, multi-factor authentication, and account lockout mechanism. Now, next is IoT security tools. We have ccat.io. This ccat.io is a security first SaaS technology to operate IoT product in a reliable, scalable and secure manner. Then we have DigiCert IoT security solution. This protects private data and home network while preventing unauthorized access using the PKI based security solution for IoT devices. Then we have the other security tools also available. These are the many other tools we have, like Norton Core, NetShield, Google Cloud IoT, Carvol. So we have these like Cisco Umbrella, Cisco IoT Threat Defense also there. So these are the different IoT tools we have for the security of IoT devices. Now next is the IoT pen testing. IoT penetration testing is the process of strengthening the IoT device's security for finding existing security loopholes in the devices and implementing the proper security controls. Pen testing of IoT devices involves testing the API application authentication policy, open ports, unencrypted information and unencrypted communication between two endpoints. So why we do the IoT pen testing? To close the unused ports and unnecessary unknown open ports, disable unnecessary services, provide protection against the unauthorized access and uses of the device, then design a mechanism for uninterrupted flow of information between two endpoints, to provide the protection against evaluating of privileges, enhance the device data encryption policy, enhance the security of web application and provide data privacy, then harden the overall device security. Now for doing the penetration testing for the IoT devices, start first with the discovering of IoT devices by using these different tools, Sudan, Sinus, Thinkful. We can try to discover the IoT devices around us, and if it is found or if it is not found, then again go for the discovery using the different tools. Now if it is found, then perform the hardware analysis by using these tools, then perform the firmware analysis or OS analysis by using these tools. Then perform the wireless protocol analysis by using the tools. Then perform mobile application testing by using these tools. Then perform the web application testing by using this tool. Then perform the cloud services testing by using these tools. Now after all those analysis, document all the findings which we have found, whatever related to these other different things like mobile platform, web application, cloud services. Whatever the vulnerabilities are there, we have to document everything, whether it is there or not there, whether it is secure and not secure, and what we can do to secure it. So finding all the documents, all the findings to provide the authorized person about the pen testing. So this is the IoT hacking we have, Internet of Things. So we have seen what kind of Internet thing, what is exactly Internet of Thing. Then what are the devices we have in the Internet of Things, and how those devices do the communication, what are the threats are we having, and what are the hacking methodology and tools we can use to hack those different IoT devices.